70.3 Chattanooga with Danielle Dingman.
Welcome to the Pursuit of the Perfect Race. I'm Coach Terry Wilson, and with each episode, I bring stories of athletes to you that share their experiences at races in order for you to learn how to have your perfect race. You'll hear stories from athletes of all ages, abilities, and races of all distances. So regardless of where you fit in, there's something in it for you. Thanks for spending some time with me today. Now let the pursuit begin.
Something that you were
24/7 all the time. Exercises and a work to lift some things up and get, make myself a little bit more flexible. And I feel like it's really been helping me keep really high elbow with the right shoulder and the right elbow get into the drop more of the right side than my left. So it's been helping. To be a location for family to come and watch the race. And so his parents came and they had some Hilton points and were able to get us set up in a Hilton that was literally like 2 blocks away from the venue, the race venue. So it was really, really convenient for us.
So maybe you were basically just downtown amongst the bustle and bustle. What was the atmosphere like for you? Was it a lot more relaxed, or was this a lot more stressful for you?
Generally, I do like to stay away from the hustle and bustle, as you call it, just just because it's a bit more calming and peaceful. Staying downtown, I gotta say, it's the convenience of being so close to everything with Illinois. But I love that around, like, there are people there getting the ready, and where they're from, talking to them about what their goals are for their ready to Illinois. So, a lot of that can be different people when you just stay close by.
So, let's talk about the food here in Chattanooga.
What was your favorite book as a kid? Especially the first, I want to say 10 miles ish or so. Less than that. Yeah, when you're kind of like leaving town to where you're getting out of some of those country roads, it can be pretty rough. You just kind of have to keep your head up because the majority of things aren't marked. And a lot of the dips or grooves or bumps in the road kind of blend in with the road, so if you're unlucky, you can easily get one of those, and if you're not paying attention, and, you know, you can do something stupid and push your button that you might regret later. I kind of forgot about all of that, so I was going to do some pre-writing and just remind myself what the course is like and get a feel for it, but I really liked the course because the climbing on the course there's like one steep hill that doesn't last very long. And most of it's just gradual stuff. We're just rollers, so, you don't lose too much speed on a lot of it. You know, that maintains a good speed and momentum as you're going through some of those rollers, which is nice. But it's a really pretty course, especially if you kind of run around. It's very scenic and it can be peaceful as well. I went up Lookout Mountain at USA Cycling Road Nationals in 2014, and went up Lookout Mountain a few times. I don't know if I'm too bad or not. I don't know.
is just getting a better setup in transition, putting out your bags, all those kinds of stuff for you.
That was pretty easy. So it's really feeling nice because it's just a one transition in a room. It's not split, which is really convenient. So the day before was Saturday, went down on the way on, checked in, breaks, and then Monday morning, this morning is when I went inside of everything else.
So as far as looking at your transition area, how do you want to lay things out?
So I generally like to put all of my things that are on the side of the bike that's away from the bike pump. So if I'm turning my bike, to prevent blisters, and especially on some areas where I've had blisters with the shoes before. With the tennis, I actually used a new pair of shoes for this race.
How did you race it?
Well, I had, so I needed new race shoes. And so I got them like a few days before the race, and I did a couple runs in them, and then I walked around in them. And then in a couple of days before the race, just to kind of get them working out a little bit. It's funny, everywhere that I vaseline it, I didn't have blisters, but like the one spot that I forgot around my heels, I've got still looking at my butt. I had some remnants of blisters from the race. But so setting everything up's pretty easy. Because with the T2, I usually just put the shoes on, I don't really use the crown. Just like all you can eat, pasta, chicken, salad, and I just ended up doing that. And because I didn't want to go up to a restaurant and have to wait for, you know, I just wanted to kind of be at home early. So we just ended up eating that. It was great.
So, as far as your plan for the race, and how you want to execute between biking and running, what was this like?
This is my family as well, and it's just kind of, for me, just trying to stay relaxed and hang on for as long as possible, and then just focus on waiting for the time to do the best I can, stay relaxed, breathing, staying calm, all of that. And then the bike, we thought, my coach, this race was a little bit different. It was interesting. Something that he told me was just a race with passion. And it's not scientific, really. You can't put numbers to that. And so, it was like, really, I just want to like, just give it what I have. And for a specific target, more speed, hurry, but it just ran its race for a minute. Speed to be. The goal was just to race the cousins. And then with the run, something we have been testing out is using heart rate. Really within the first like 4 miles or so, keeping it within a target range. And then we found that I've been having a lot of success in just going on the curve and turning my pace off. It's just kind of playing my games because you can get, at least me, I mean, I can get stuck in this mindset of, okay, I should be running this pace or this heart rate to equate to that pace. Starts happening, it's like you just turn it right down and turn off all of that concern, turn off pace, and just run. And that's my strategy for the run.
Now, as far as your emotions go in this race, is this different from the race weekend for you, or is there anything else going on in your life that was maybe pulling in a different direction instead of maybe you want to execute this race versus other races?
Being a pro athlete, I think, was kind of like, you look, I'm trying to find where it works for this. People think it's glamorous. Like, oh my gosh, you're a pro athlete, whatever. And with the great little view, you know, like how we're everywhere, or how we have the best equipment. Just be able to train and race all the time. Expectations of what you should be doing and how things should look, and really is that when all your expenses are covered, at least initially when you're so new into the sport. Celebrate my progress and not become what I like the outcome, because the outcome that will come, I'm just going to staying competitive versus staying
competitive. So it seems like you don't have to compare yourself to others, and sometimes even not compare yourself to yourself. How do you do this?
To start next time, you know what you have to do. I feel like you have to do both cautiously. So, can I say that? Is that loud?
Yeah, it makes sense too.
Because you want to make sure that you are improving, right? So you compare yourself to yourself in where you've been. I think what you can't do so much is compare yourself to this idealistic version of what you want to be, because then you can get stuck in this phase of just constantly berating or beating yourself down. So I think comparing yourself to where you've been and celebrating the progress and where you are now is really important. But keeping in mind where you want to go, and you can't continue to always compare yourself to that. And then in regards to other people, I think it can somewhat be a fair measure of some of the progress you made, but at the same time, everybody's on their own journey, and so you have to be careful with how much you're comparing yourself to other people, because, it can just be a slippery slope that can lead you to putting in your headspace.
You probably do that.
I'd say probably struggle with comparing myself to where I want to be. And then I think when it comes to comparing myself to others, I still hope something like it's tough, race after race, getting my butt kicked in the slam. But that's where I have to come back to comparing myself to where I've been, because my swim has improved a ton in the past year. Something to celebrate.
Right. So, the race itself, that quarter race, how much did you get?
The quarter race is usually less than 2 days beforehand for me, just because I get excited. So, I don't know, I think I went to bed around 8:30 and got up at 4, but I really kind of started starting around 1 a.m.
When you actually get out of bed and start eating, right?
I think I got out of bed around 4:15. And then I left the hotel around 5. And then we were just able to walk down to the transition area.
Okay. Now, before you leave,
the race start was 6:55 or so, somewhere there.
6:54, and so 6:55 for women.
Yep.
And then I converse. Tim is behind you.
Okay.
So, story on the sunscreen. What do you use for sunscreen, and how do you make sure you don't really burn?
I just have some, waterproof sunscreen. I just spray everywhere.
Okay.
When I didn't burn.
Well, you were out there a very long time, so. That was a rotational. I was out there for almost 6 hours. And then you were out just open ahead of me.
And you need some, really cool.
Yeah. Look at that glitter shirt. This is all you you get down to the transition area right before it closes on the host. And how does this go for you?
I was doing good. I had the whole morning kind of chatting about, which you always do, get out of transition and get your stuff set up, get your warm up started. And all of this, but I got down there and met. It was like transition was already set up, everything, everybody was like done. I'm like, am I late? What time is it? I was like, it's really starting to freak out. I guess I didn't get it out there. And I'm like, what's going on? Are you already back? You're getting on the bus, you're already going. Like, my stuff isn't even set up yet. So I had to take a deep breath and say, you can be a little right on schedule. It's all going to be okay. So, I went down and got my vehicle and they actually, instead of taking the bus across the bridge to choose an area. One person brought his bike with him. He just kind of carried my stuff with him. He ride the bike, and I go to run for a over, you know, a short start. So it was like a mile and a half or so. And going over there, you know, you kind of share some drills and a nice one scan and make that long walk going to the slow start.
Sort of kind of set up in like its own little village almost. There's part of it. I heard that there was this massive lab effort on the aid station. They have water pumps up there. How was all this type of stuff for you, passing all these age groupers, just to get the start of the
month? It's a fun atmosphere. You know, I mean, in general, people are pretty excited. It's interesting to see how people handle pre-race dinners. I guess that a little bit differently. You know, you have people that are just sitting there really quietly, you have chiller boxes. Yeah. People are going to jump around or whatever. I feel like I'm pretty cool, calm, and collected. Like, I don't just sit down, I don't jump around. But, like, maybe take a little. I talked to a few people, but it's kind of going to stay in my own zone, and, you know, I don't know how to explain it. It's just the zone, right?
Yeah. So, the pros go off after the match, and, in and out, so probably down into the water. This year was a little bit different than last year because the ramp going into the water was kind of like this weird thing, and you had to go hold on to that.
Basically, you just get in the water, you can feel the current pushing against you. And so, it's nice to have, you have the opportunity to do a warm up instead of just spend, five or 7 minutes or so getting adjusted to the water with the current and getting a good feel for it. Hard time getting connected from the beginning because I lined up towards the outside and I just didn't want that to happen again. And so that's why I chose to really remember the work that I was in the field.
Okay. All right. So the flow itself, first 2 hours are upstream and you have a ride, and then another ride go downstream. How does this section go?
This section is actually about 350 up.
350 up, okay.
Mm-hmm. So I was with the group for a while, and then I just don't know how I just managed to find myself alone again. Maybe it was before that first right-hand turn. I tried to get to the I didn't stick, so I got on my car and just meet myself and I to hang out for the rest of the swim. Actually, it's funny, I set up the kayakers around me, and I felt like there was more animals watching me than normal, and I thought, you know what? I'm probably just following me because I'm the last person. And I'm probably just like, they're probably timing out of the way I am. And the main group. And they tell me if they're going to be first, which first or not. Thanks to my terrible slam, these groupers probably won't have That's just terrible. So, welcome, these groupers. Your Democrat's slam was awful because of my terrible slam.
Well,
yeah, actually, I was going to say it was terrible. I actually looked back at my training peak stuff from last year, and I swam, when I was 8 seconds faster per 100 this year, so I feel like that's progress.
Now, you can't do it for a comparison of times. You can't, because this year was the actual full distance, and last year was not, was that right?
Yeah, I was thinking my training peak last year set about 1700, whereas this year was right around that 2100, maybe a touch more.
Okay. So, on the down river portion, were you on a teaching by how, or were you still in the hallways the last pro and last day of pro level, or what's the sign?
You didn't have any catch me, buddy.
No. But it's like most of the picture you did on Instagram. You're like, oh, it's okay.
Yeah, sometimes I think I'm the last person, and then I feel someone like touch my foot, and I'm like, oh, I'm the last person. So I thought maybe, there's somebody behind me, but nope.
So, this portion of the swim, how does this go for you? If you have any kind of bags, you can bring a bag, you can bring some water.
Like, whatever water. Intentionally, I don't think that I do.
Okay. So, you know, how's it going to go for you? You're an empty one for less than 3 months.
Yeah. I came out of that water. It was tough, though, because first time I looked back at the finisher picks, I don't know what the deal is. I just felt like I had to run through all of transition of my tongue out. And I was like, smiling and laughing. And because I was having a really good time, I really had a fast transition run. There's a lot of volunteers out there just like clapping and cheering, and so I don't know, when I was out in front, I just printed up that ramp, just trying to like have a really high knee drive, use my arms for that ramp coming out of water. It's really steep. Yeah, it's very steep. So
I imagine that before my knee decreases a little bit.
Yeah, so I just tried to power up that thing. But you have to be careful because the cement sections of transition, they can be slick, man. And there are some really sharp, like, kind of eating returns going through transition. So I just had to be careful that I wasn't going to eat it. but I just tried to power through and run as fast as I possibly could with those long runs of the bike.
Yeah, but before we get into the weeds with the bike here, this pro race is a little bit different than the pro races I've seen. The females have the little numbers and the males have the high numbers. What
Okay, yeah. It'll probably be like 1 through 50 or something like that. And then the one that you have for the last one. And so what that does for them is it just gives them a little bit better of a starting position as far as getting their bikes because they're the closest to the exit when transition. So it just makes them have just a little bit more of an advantage. That's really consistent.
Yes.
ridiculous hike for me in a race that I've ever had.
Ridiculous.
Ridiculous. And I mean every sense of that word. So, okay, so I said, okay, on the bike, most of my garment, right? So it's like maybe like, I don't know, 5-ish minutes for me to get that thing back up. Once I got that back up, I realized my heart rate monitor wasn't working. Okay? I didn't really rely on my right arm to get in when I used
the power meter.
Yeah. That's a different.
Yeah, it's that one. I don't remember names of that, but how would you want to put it versus power in a race?
I mean, your heart rate, I mean, these are the things can vary based on the conditions outside, your stress levels, hydration, nutrition. You know, for me, like, it's time that I like to try to do the first 20 minutes. Ideally, less than that, and my heart rate down into a reasonable number. And generally, when I get out of the bike, it's like going for that transition time of running into your bike, and there's that adrenaline rush that you have in the first few minutes. And it can take a few minutes for that heart rate to drop and settle in. As I found in races, when it's spiked for like 3 or 4 minutes, my rush is really, really because of that. And so that's my way to just kind of keep that heart rate in check really within the first, I'd say, 20 minutes or so of the bike. And then I will look at it though during the race just to make sure I don't get too crazy.
Okay. So
going back to work, you can see what else is there. Okay, so now, okay. Well, I mentioned at the road for us, I remember passing over a certain rough section and just seeing like water pools everywhere. Thankfully, I didn't lose any water bottles. We did accidentally drop a gel. Like, okay, water goes 100 calories. And then I'm like, all right, well, I'll just kind of keep my nutrition plan the same. Losing one gel, it's okay. It's not that huge of a deal. And then I dropped another gel. I guess another 100 calories. When I dropped that one, I'm like, should I go back and get it? No, just trying to bike. And so then I, in order to recoup from that, I just decided to take Gatorade from the aid stations. I normally don't usually just take water, but I took Gatorade from the aid stations this time. Maybe that helped kind of replace some of those calories. So then, okay, so the garment issue, the heart rate, the boots, what else? I saw girls on the side of the road, flat tire, it just turned out to be a crazy day for everybody. And then, around, I want to say, like 40 and 45, when you go through that small town, it's probably the one, like, with some, like, narrow, it looks like you're going down, like, through a main street, right? So that it's really narrow. There's no shoulder for cyclists. Well, I came out of the water, like, 27th, right, last. And then, at that point, it's when I said I didn't really know how many women started the race. They knew that I was last on the water, so whenever I would catch somebody, I'm like, okay, that's one, okay, that's two, that's three, right, up the road, there was number four. So I kept a tally of, like, how many people I was catching on the bike. And so I don't know, maybe I'm around, like, middle 40, and check my mind, I think I was sitting around, maybe that when I had passed more than 12 people or so. And there were two girls right behind of me, and I was making ground up, but then there was like three cars behind them. They were, because I'm going faster, I'm up from getting closer to all of these vehicles, and what you don't want to do is you don't want to sit behind the vehicle because then you can get into overdrafting. So I'm like, okay, do I take yes, I left, and I understand from it to the right. But if I went to the left, I would have been crossing the yellow line and going into oncoming traffic, which is also, number one, it's unsafe, and she didn't get in trouble for that. And so I'm like, well, I'll go on the inside to the right. So I pass one car, I pass two cars, land, this big truck decides it wants to make a right-hand turn on the side of the street. And I'm putting up on a green light. And so then I have to brake really fast over some really rough road. And so because I'm braking for my vehicle, a rough road, my handlebars start going like, I'm not going to be able to slow down enough time to make a sharp right-hand turn off course down this side street. I go down on U-turn, and then just kind of like, didn't have to like weave through their cubes to get back onto the course. And then that could have been a really bad situation. But I was able to get myself kind of back up to speed. And then catching those other two girls, just trying to shake it off. I think it took a few minutes for me to kind of get my legs back under me and just relax from that. But then, another vehicle that was basically driving through the feed zone with us, but there was another approaching at the same time as this vehicle. It was maybe 3 feet from my left shoulder. And I'm trying to take a bottle to my right. And I just yelled at the volunteer, is not like me, and I'm like, hey, get this guy out of here. And I think they were trying to like get him away because he was impeding our progress for quite some time. And we were really advanced to have him close to us. But then, after that happened, I was on the bed when they had the road to the end of the line. I was taking a really popping thing, heading back towards town, and then kind of when you make it back into the neighborhood, you make that sharp right.
Huge.
I said it to them. never conclude. I forgot how they won't make it into transition. I just made it too small. Except I did, I mean, because we have low numbers, I did accidentally, like, run past my transition area. You know, I have a little rock. Things don't run really fast transition. First, like, few steps off the bike, because you always kind of wonder, okay, how are the legs going to feel today? Because there's times you can get off the bike and you're like, am I ever going to try a little bit more on the legs? Or there's times you get off the bike, like, man, these things are spraying. So I think I got off the bike and I felt like I had just done 56 miles, but I was still capable of running 13. I mean, it was like somewhere in the middle.
So you don't really need to use your bike this time. Just run past it, which doesn't really cost you much time in the grand scheme of things.
That's why I ran past it, and then I'm like looking at the numbers, I'm like, why are these numbers getting higher? I think I said, like, oh, I'm number 17, turn around, and I'm running the other direction. And there was another pro that heard me say all of that, and she said she got a big kick out of that, and was laughing at me, and she was like, shit.
So, we're in T2 already, but you actually said something on the bike ride that you normally don't say.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Okay, no. Okay. No. Yeah, I got it. No. Thank you. the bridge is not over, as you're both exposed. How does this run go for you?
It went really well. Someone told me I was sitting in 11th, I believe, going into the run. I think that's right. Because they get a pass a girl or two in transition. And so I knew what I still wanted to try to get myself in the top 10. But it was questionable to me if I was really going to be able to catch any more girls. Like I said, I didn't have my heart rate data, so my strategy that I was going to use was out the window. And so what's interesting is that I never once looked at my watch during the run race, the run. And the run actually, I feel like, went by a lot quicker than most of the other runs, not like physically, but just like mentally. I was able to actually make up quite a bit of ground. And it's funny, you know, I see some of these girls out running the course, and I'm like, man, the form looks awesome. They look really strong. They look like they're hauling. There's no way I'm going to catch them. And then, like, you know, a few miles later, I find, oh, I just caught that person. Oh, I guess my run form must look good. Well, I guess I might be looking fast. That's kind of cool. I don't know. That's just things I think. So, I mean, of course, it hurt. You know, like, I feel like my headspace was really positive during this, and I didn't have much expectation. I just kind of wanted to run and have fun with it and push myself where I could. And I tried to really use the downhills and, try to use some of the sections, like in the swamp land, for example. There's a lot of like wide corners where you can make up some ground. And if there's, you know, like there's someone behind you, you can make a turn where they don't see you anymore. Throw in a surge the next time they see you, you're further away. So it's just kind of like playing a little bit of mind games, right? Somebody cheered for me when they did that. She turned around and saw me. She didn't know I was coming. She turned around and saw me, and she took off sprinting, and so I didn't get her. I was late by like 7 seconds, right? Seconds. So,
was this the hardest scene of life that you services and it's like given this map, services to the finish line this before? Is this like one of the hardest things you've ever to the finish line?
Yeah, definitely, yeah. It's just hard, for sure.
So, at these services at the end, it seems like you could have left them on the table somewhere else.
I don't think so. I don't think so. I mean, I feel like, you can always look back in retrospect and think, oh, we could have done this or should have done this. And I really feel like I pushed myself during the run. Maybe the whole course of the thing could have been a little bit faster. But there comes a point when you're finishing a race and you know it's time to dig deep. You're always able to find a little extra air. I think that's really what it was. It was just kind of that moment of, I have to try. But it took me back to my days of racing at college. I was an 800 runner. So, I had my whole all time. So, I had to pull back to my roots.
This is always special for you to see him at the finish line. What's this like for you?
I was really thankful to be done. I think I was pretty tired after that one. I was good. So my in-laws were there at the finish line. Grayson was there at the finish line. So it was, after I spoke to some of the other athletes, I congratulated the girlers to have me. So it's a good finish on her part. And then I went to my family and it's always nice finishing a race, knowing that you gave the best that you did, and so you can celebrate that with your family. I think that's really special.
Nice. So, if you finish, what do you next?
Baked.
Okay.
Well, yeah, that's all about. That's what we had. But then we went to a place that we went to last year, which is so good. It's called Tupelo Honey in Chattanooga. I had blueberry pancakes and grits and eggs, and it's good.
Nice. You know, they have each day, for me to finish.
I did. I stood out there forever, Jeremy, waiting for you in that heat. I could have showered, eaten, and been back. Today for a pro, or another person, if it's finished. But for me, I mean, if you
Thanks for tuning in today. I hope you were able to learn something from today's episode. If you enjoy the show, please take a minute to leave a review on iTunes or share it with a friend. Be sure to subscribe so you never miss an episode. If you'd like to see pictures from this athlete's race, learn more about who I am, what I'm doing, or be on the show yourself to share your story, check out my website at CoachTerryWilson.com. Until next time, continue the pursuit.